Cyber crimes. According to the director of US National Infrastructure Protection Center, that is NIPC, cyber crimes present the greatest danger to e-commerce and the general public in general. The threat of crime using the internet is real and growing, and it is likely to be the scourge of the 21st century. A cyber crime is a crime like any other crime, except that in this case, the illegal act must involve a connected computing system, either as an object of a crime, an instrument used to commit a crime, or a repository of evidences related to a crime. Alternatively, one can define a cybercrime as an act of unauthorized intervention into the working of the telecommunication networks or oblique and the sanctioning of an authorized access to the resources of the computing elements in a network that lead to a threat to the system's infrastructure or life that or cause a significant property loss. Because of the variations in jurisdiction boundaries, cyber acts are defined as illegal in different ways depending on the communities in those boundaries. Communities define acts to be illegal if such acts fall within the domains of that community's commission of crimes that a legislature of a state or a nation has specified and approved. Both the International Convention of Cyber Crimes and the European Convention on Cyber Crimes have outlined the list of these crimes to include the following: unlawful access to information, illegal interception of information, unlawful use of telecommunication equipment, forgery with use of computer measures, intrusion of the public switched and packet network, network integrity violations, privacy violations, industrial espionage, pirated computer software, fraud using the computing system, internet email abuse, using computers or computer technology to commit murder, terrorism, pornography, and hacking. Because for any crime to be classified as a cyber crime, it must be committed with the help of a computing resource. Cyber crimes are executed in one of two ways: penetration and denial of service attacks. Who are cyber criminals? They are ordinary users of cyberspace with a message. As the number of users swells, the number of criminals among them also increases at almost the same rate. A number of studies have identified the following groups as the most likely sources of cybercrimes. Insiders. For a long time, system attacks were limited to in-house employee-generated attacks to system and theft of company property. In fact, disgruntled insiders are a major source of computer crimes because they do not need a great deal of knowledge about the victim computer system. In many cases, such insiders use the system every day. This allows them to gain unrestricted access to the computer system, thus causing damage to the computer system and or data. The 1999 Computer Security Institute, BBI, report notes that 55% of respondents reported malicious activity by insiders. Hackers. Hackers are actually computer enthusiasts who know a lot about computers and computer networks and use this knowledge with a criminal intent. Since the mid-1980s, computer network hacking has been on the rise mostly because of the widespread use of the internet. Criminal groups. A number of cybercrimes are carried out by criminal groups for different motives, ranging from settling scores to pure thievery. For example, such criminal groups with hacking abilities have broken into credit card companies to steal thousands of credit card numbers. Disgruntled ex-employees. Many studies have shown that disgruntled ex-employees also pose a serious threat to organizations as source of cybercrimes, targeting their former employers for a number of employee-employer issues that led to the separation. In some cases, employees simply use their knowledge of the system to attack the organization for purely financial gains. Economic espionage spies. The growth of cyberspace and e-commerce and the forces of globalization have created a new source of crime syndicates, the organized economic spies that plow the internet looking for company secrets. As the price tag for original research skyrockets and competition in the marketplace becomes global, companies around the globe are ready to pay any amount for stolen commercial, marketing, and industrial secrets. The word hacker has changed meaning over the years as technology changed. Currently, the word has two opposite meanings. One definition talks of a computer enthusiast as an individual who enjoys exploring the details of computers and how to stretch their capabilities, as opposed to the most users who prefer to learn only the minimum necessary. The opposite definition talks of a malicious or inquisitive meddler who tries to discover information by poking around before acquiring its current derogatory meaning. The term hacking used to mean expert writing and modification of computer programs. Hackers were considered people who were highly knowledgeable about computing. They were considered computer experts who could make the computer do all the wonders through programming. Today, however, hacking refers to a process of gaining unauthorized access into a computer system for a variety of purposes, including stealing of and altering of data and electronic demonstrations. For some time now, hacking as a political or social demonstration has been used during international crisis. During a crisis period, hacking attack and other internet security breaches usually spike, in part because of sentiments over the crisis. For example, during the two Iraq wars, there were elevated levels of hacker activities. According to Atlanta-based internet security systems, around the start of the first Iraq war, there was a sharp increase of about 37% from the fourth quarter of the year before, the largest quarterly spike the company has ever recorded. There are several subsects of hackers based on hacking philosophies. The biggest subsect are crackers, hacktivists, and cyber terrorists. Crackers. A cracker is one who breaks security on a system. Crackers are the hardcore hackers characterized more as professional security breakers and thieves. The term was recently coined only in the mid-1980s by purist hackers who wanted to differentiate themselves from individuals with criminal motives whose sole purpose is to sneak through security systems. Purist hackers were concerned journalists were misusing the term hacker. They were worried that mass media has failed to understand the distinction between computer enthusiasts and computer criminals, calling both hackers. The distinction has, however, failed, so the two terms hack and crack are still being often used interchangeably. Even though the public still does not know the difference between hackers and crackers, purist hackers are still arguing that there is a big difference between what they do and what crackers do. For example, they say cyber terrorists, cyber vandals, and all criminal hackers are not hackers, but crackers by the above definition. There is a movement now of reformed crackers who are turning their hacking knowledge into legitimate use, forming enterprises to work for and with cybersecurity companies and sometimes law enforcement agencies to find and patch potential security breaches before their former counterparts can take advantage of them. Types of attacks. Whatever their motives, hackers have a variety of techniques in their arsenal to carry out their goals. Let us look at some of them here. Social engineering, impersonation, data attacks, infrastructure weaknesses, active wiretap. The rapid growth of internet has led to a corresponding growth of both users and activities in cyberspace. Unfortunately, not all these users and their activities are reputable. Thus, the internet has been increasingly at least too many individuals and businesses turning into a bad internet. Bad people are plowing the internet with evil activities that include, among other things, intrusion into company and individual systems looking for company data and individual information that erodes privacy and security. There has therefore been a need to protect company systems and now individual PCs, keeping them out of access from those bad users, out of the bad internet. As companies build private networks and decide to connect them onto the internet, network security becomes one of the most important concerns network administrators face. In fact, these network administrators are facing threats from two fronts, the external internet and the internal users within the company network. So, network system administrators must be able to find ways to restrict access to the company network or sections of the network from both the bad internet outside and from unscrupulous inside users. Such security mechanisms are based on firewall. A firewall is a hardware, software, or a combination of both that monitors and filters traffic packet that attempt to either enter or leave the protected private network. It is a tool that separates a protected network or part of a network, and now increasingly a user PC from an unprotected network, the bad network like the internet. In many cases, the bad network may even be part of the company network. By definition, a firewall is a tool that provides a filter of both incoming and outgoing packets. Types of firewalls. Firewalls are used very widely to offer network security services. This has resulted in a large repertoire of firewall. To understand the many different types of firewalls, we need only look at the kind of security services firewalls offer at different layers of the TCP/DP protocol stack. 1. Packet inspection firewalls. 2. Application proxy server, filtering based on known services. 3. Virtual private network, that is VPN firewalls. Small office home office, that is SOHO firewalls. NAT firewalls. A computer virus is a program that infects a chosen system resource such as a file and may even spread within the system and beyond. Hackers have used various types of viruses in the past as tools, including 1. Memory resident virus, error generating virus, data and program destroyers, system crushers, computer time theft virus, hardware destroyers, logic time bombs, trojans, trapdoors, and hoaxes. A computer virus is a self-propagating computer program designed to alter or destroy a computer system resource. The term virus is derived from a Latin word virus, which means poison. For generations, even before the birth of modern medicine, the term had remained mostly in medical circles, meaning a foreign agent injecting itself in a living body, feeding on it to grow and multiply. As it reproduces itself in the new environment, it spreads throughout the victim's body slowly, disabling the body's natural resistance to foreign objects, weakening the body's ability to perform needed life functions, and eventually causing serious, sometimes fatal, effect to the body. Computer viruses also parallel the natural viruses. However, instead of using the living body, they use software, that is executable codes, to attach themselves, grow, reproduce, and spread in the new environment. Executing the surrogate program starts them off and they spread in the new environment, attacking major system resources that sometimes include the surrogate software itself, data, and sometimes hardware, weakening the capacity of these resources to perform the needed functions and eventually bringing the system down. The word virus was first assigned a non-biological meaning in the 1972 science section stories about the GOD machine that were compiled into a book titled When Harley Was One by David Garrod. Later association of the term with a real world computer program was by Fred Cohen, then a graduate student at the University of Southern California. Cohen wrote 5 programs, actually viruses, to run on a WAX 11 FL50 running Unix, not to alter or destroy any computer resources, but for class demonstration. During the demonstration, each virus obtained full control of the system within an hour. From that simple and harmless beginning, computer viruses have been on the rise. Computer viruses are so far the most prevalent, most devastating, and the most widely used form of computer system attack. And of all types of systems attacks, it is the fastest growing. One, ease of generation. Considering all other types of system attacks, viruses are the easiest to generate because the majority of them are generated from computer code. The writing of computer code has been becoming easier every passing day because, first, programming languages are becoming easier to learn and develop programs. Second, there are more readily available virus codes floating around on the internet. And finally, there is plenty of help for would-be virus developer in terms of material and physical support. Material support in form of how-to manuals and turnkey virus programs is readily available free on the internet. 2. Scope of reach. Because of the high degree of interconnection of global computers, the speed at which viruses are spread is getting faster and faster. The speed at which the code red virus spread from Philippines through Asia to Europe to North America attests to this. Within a few days of release, code red had the global network under its grip. 3. Self-propagating nature of viruses. The new viruses now are far more dangerous than their counterparts several years ago. New viruses self-propagate, which gives them the ability to move fast and create more havoc faster. One of the reasons that the code red virus was able to move so fast was that it was self-propagating. 4. Mutating virus. The new virus are not only self-propagating, which gives them speed, but they are also mutating, which gives them a double punch of delaying quick eradication and consuming great resources and therefore destroying more in their wake, fulfilling the intended goals of the developers. 5. Difficult to apprehend the developer. As the code red virus demonstrated, owing to legal and other limitations, it is getting more and more difficult to apprehend the culprits. This in itself is giving encouragement to would-be virus developers that they can really get away with impunity. Just like living viruses, there are several types of digital or computer viruses, and there are new brand almost every the other day. We will give 2 classification of computer viruses based on transmission and outcomes. 1. Trojan horse viruses. The viruses are labeled Trojan horse viruses because, just like in the old myth in which the Greeks, as enemies of Troy, used a large wooden horse to hide in and enter the city of Troy, these viruses use the tricks these legendary Greeks used. During transmission, they hide into trusted common programs such as compilers, editors, and other commonly used programs. Once they are safely into the target program, they become alive whenever the program executes. 2. Polymorphic viruses. These viruses are literally those that change form. Before a polymorphic virus replicates itself, it must change itself into some other form in order to avoid detection. This means that if the virus detector had known the signature for it, this signature then changes. Modern virus generators have learned to hide the virus signatures from antivirus softwares by encrypting the virus signatures and then transforming them. These mutations are giving virus hunter a really hard time. The most notorious mutating virus was the code red virus, which mutated into almost a different form every the other day, throwing virus hunters off track. 3. Stealth virus. Just like the polymorphic virus uses mutation to distract its hunters from its track, a stealth virus makes modifications to the target files and the system's boot record, then it hides these modifications. It hides these modifications by interjecting itself between the application programs. The operating system must report to and the operating system itself. In this position, it receives the operating system reports and falsifies them as they are being sent to the programs. In this case, therefore, the programs and the antivirus detector would not be able to detect its presence. Once it is ready to strike, then it does so. 4. Retrovirus. A retrovirus is an antivirus fighter. It works by attacking antivirus software on the target machine so that it can either disable it or bypass it. In fact, that is why it is sometimes called an anti-antivirus program. Other retroviruses focus on disabling the database of integrity information in the integrity checking software, another member of the antivirus family. 5. Multipartite virus. Multipartite virus is a multifaceted virus that is able to attack the target computer from several fronts. It is able to attack the boot record and all boot sectors of disks, including floppies, and it is also able to attack executable files. Because of this, it was nicknamed multipartite. 6th, armored virus. Probably the name is fitting because this virus works the target computer by first protecting itself so that it is more difficult to be detected, trace, disassemble, or understand its signature. It gets the coat or armor by using an outer layer of protective coat that cannot easily be penetrated by antivirus software. Other forms of this virus work by not using a protective coat but by hiding from antivirus software. 7. Companion virus. This is a smarter virus that works by creating companions with executable. Then it piggybacks on the executable file and produces its own extension based on the executable file. By so doing, every time the executable software is launched, it always executes first. 8. Fake virus. This virus parallels and is named after its biological counterpart that replaces an infected cell with itself. The computer counterpart also replaces the executable code with its own code. Because of its ability to do this, and just like its biological cousin, it is very destructive and dangerous. It destroys every executable program it comes into contact with. Dealing with rising cyber crimes in general and hacking activities in particular, in this fast-moving computer communication revolution in which everyone is likely to be affected, is a major challenge not only to the people in the security community but for all of us. We must devise means that will stop the growth, stop and spiral, and protect the system from attacks. But this fight is already cut out for us, and it be tough in that we are chasing the enemy who seems on many occasions to know more than we do and is constantly ahead of us. Preventing cyber crimes requires an enormous amount of effort and planning. The goal is to have advanced information before an attack occurs. However, the challenge is to get this advanced information. Also, getting this information in advance does not help very much unless we can quickly analyze it and plan to appropriate response in time to prevent the systems from being adversely affected. In real life, however, there is no such thing as the luxury of advanced information before an attack.